a number of Mozilla engineers here, in particular from the graphics team. And I hope we'll have lots of fun discussing the talks and just talking to each other about random stuff. And I'm also hoping to get a little bit of a question in for you. And that's what I'm going to start with so that you're warmed up. Right after. So, first quiz question: when was the last Toronto meetup? The exact date. Not necessarily here in Toronto.
Yeah.
You get the super button.
Just also Rust 1.0 release.
Yes, I remember you. Awesome. So we have a few talks, but before we start listening, we would like everyone to introduce each other. So please tell us who you are, why you are here, and what's your language background is. And we can use this fancy microphone with the cube, starting with Jeff.
Okay. I'm on the graphics team here at Mozilla. That's meant that I've mostly been working in C++, but we're moving a bunch of stuff over to Rust. So that's what I've been writing a lot in lately.
My name is Michael. I'm on the DOM team here at Mozilla. I work on random Rust stuff occasionally, but mostly C++.
My name's Ted. I'm on the JavaScript team. I do no Rust here, but I've looked at it in the past and curious to see what the current state of the world is.
All right. It's okay, my fault. I'm Trevor. I work here on the accessibility 10S teams, I guess. I do a lot of C++, a little bit of Rust at this point.
Hi, I'm Tanner. My background is video games. I mostly do JavaScript and C++.
My name's Glenn. I do infrastructure development. My language background is pretty polyglot. It's mostly Java and Python these days. I like doing Rust. It's pretty interesting systems language, and I'm trying to squeak it into my work.
Hi, my name is Amid. I work at 500px. I'm a mobile developer, so primarily work with Java and Swift these days. But I'm more interested in getting involved in compilers and such, so Rust has been on my radar.
Hello, I'm Marianne. I've been working with Go and Ruby mostly, and I'm interested in Rust because of the garbage collection lists of Rust.
I'm Aaron. I am primarily a web developer, so I work with like JavaScript and Ruby. Interested in Rust for game development stuff, graphics, and really a lot of other things. It's a pretty neat language.
Hi, my name is Alexei. I primarily work with Scala and Java, and I think Rust is a great low-level language to kind of plug into those tools when you need to.
Name is Curtis, and I'm a QA person. I'm just here to hear more about Rust.
Hi, I'm Neil. I'm a web developer, and I'm interested in Rust because I do a lot of like Haskell on my own time, and I kind of want a language that has that type system, but for systems applications.
I'm Aaron. I'm not a developer, but I do occasionally work in R, and I like Rust for everything else.
Hi, I'm Dale. I do web development during the day, and I'm interested in Rust for games and graphics and web stuff, too.
Hey, I'm Sagata. I'm also a web developer. I mostly work in Ruby, but really interested in Rust. Trying to see how that world sort of evolves as it comes into its own being.
Hi, I'm Dorian. I'm a web developer, mostly working on Python and JavaScript, but I like working with Rust because it's a much more reasonable systems level programming language than C or C++.
Hi, I'm Tim. I'm a cryptography engineer, so I'm interested in Rust for the memory safety, but also like the features of a high-level language.
Hey, I'm Alexei. I work on the graphics team with the others. I've been working on Rust for a long time. I don't know. It's cool.
Hey, my name is Flux. I'm a web developer. I'm using Rust to build web system using Rust and the Diesel framework. I'm come here to learn more. Okay, thank you.
So we hope that everyone will like it and we'll get the chance to do this more often, because obviously once it's yours, it's not acceptable for us. And I also kindly ask you to feel yourself relaxed and at home, because otherwise we'll not have a good discussion. And there's washrooms there if you need, and pizza and drinks will come a bit later. So hold on, we'll get there. I'm going to start with talk about entity component systems in Rust. And I'm Dmitry Malyshev, or Quark, on IFC and GitHub. And I'm a long time member of Rust community and was mostly doing the game dev stuff. So let's go. Yeah, so ECS, entity component system, has two different aspects. The model of thinking, where everything is just a set of components, basically, and all the components are, they can be anything, basically. So an entity is defined only by the components it has and nothing else. That model of thinking can be seen as a framework where you build systems and think about architecture. And the other aspect of it is how you lay down the data so that the access is sequential and hardware is very efficient at processing your large amounts of data. So these two aspects combined together provide a good way to build effective, performant systems from the ground up. And that's very applicable to a number of domains, but mostly for game dev, where you would see entity component system in one shape or another in practically any production engine. Okay. I came from Rockstar here, a recent hire, you would say, and even there we have some sort of ECS under the hood. And I expect like any engine go in this direction. So people have been trying to make different entity component systems in Rust from very long time, from basically when Rust appeared first. So we have these terms. We have an entity that's just, as I said, a collection of components. We have a component. The main idea about the component is that it's independent of other components. That's how you build system, right? So you divide and conquer. And a system is a function that processes some number of components of entities. A system picks up entities in an ad hoc manner. So it may say that I need components A and B, and it will process all the entities that have those components. That's like the most effective thing that ECS has and other approaches to architecture may not have. So this is something that I do as a basically a graph of things before conversion to ECS. And that's how it looks with ECS. You would have entities pointing to different components and a component storage A, there is component storage B, and each entity may point to I think some arrows are incorrect there, but you got the idea. So what doesn't work for ECS? If it's so good, why not everyone is using it? Like I said, the game dev is using it, but game dev is not everything, right? Dependent components obviously don't map very well. if you want to encode a node graph spatial tree, then you may have problems since different implementations may have different limitations, as in you may not be able to share a component, for example, between different entities. Also, if you have different groups of entities, for example, you have the game system and you have the menu and you want them to be in the same entity component system, the menu will have entirely different set of components from the game. And if you want them all to be together, you would be paying overhead since the implementation may not be optimized in the best way for different disjoint groups of entities. This is a performance concern. Yeah, and non-uniform dependencies mean that a system may or may not depend on something based on runtime. So that's what some implementations don't like either. You cannot just fetch something if you haven't thought of it in advance. Now the specs is the first parallel processing entity component system. That's what I'll be mostly talking about. It was born on April. It was born in the discussions about the Amethyst game engine, and it was made by me and Colin Sherratt. It's when it was born, we got a benchmark by a third party where we edited ourselves and then tuned up the performance to beat everything in existence, basically, by a margin. You would see benchmarks a bit later. So this is the example of a system that we have. You could see that this code is split in multiple parts. The part at the top where the fetch function is called is where we request the data that we're going to work with. So we say that we want to write into the bullet component and we want to enumerate the entities. So once the fetch finishes, then we actually do the processing. When we modify the actual lifetime of a bullet, and then if the lifetime is gone, then we ask it to delete. Notice how the deletion is done in the processing phase. We support asynchronous entity creation and deletion. So you could do this from anywhere with multiple systems simultaneously. The reason why we have different two phases is how we approach parallelism. It's we treat components as entirely separate things in the world. Component storages know about the entities that they have, and when we run systems and schedule them, we just don't allow the same component storage to be mutated by more than one system, very similar to how Rust borrowing works. So the first phase is what's done sequentially, as in it's done on one thread, on the planar thread. It's just allowing every system to get the hold of the component storages to work with. And then once the system grabbed those storages, it's departing into a separate thread, and then it's doing the actual work processing them. So you can see how this is limited in the way it parallelizes things. Like, it can get stuck on one of the systems that ask too much because everything is locked by other systems. But essentially, it allows for some sort of parallelism. We never claim that we are optimal in this way, and there is a lot of ways we can get even faster now. So here's the brief list of features. So we do sort of a automatic parallelization in a way I just explained, and our components are entirely abstract. You could do anything as your component. You could have completely abstract storages as well. For example, for some components which are very often encountered on the entities, we would use vectors. On the others, we would use hash maps, or you could do a B-tree map if you like those fancy structures, or you can implement your own component storage. At the same time, we don't do any dynamic dispatch, so there's no overhead of actually having this abstraction. It's still very fast, and we can iterate over a number of component storages. We even have like an operator of negation, which will tell us operate on the entities that don't have this component as opposed to have this component. And we don't have macros. I think that's one of the like good things, since macros obscure the code flow a lot. And people who are familiar with JeffXRS will may confirm that the usage of macros there is often one point of complaints. So this is the performance graph, and this is the microseconds we spend on benchmark iteration. The specs is the third there. We see the light blue color is building of entities, and the dark blue is processing of them. The processing really takes nothing, simply because we do it in parallel. Building is also very efficient because we can batch create entities. And the other entity component systems here are the ones that the author of the benchmark decided to do, or the authors of this component system decided to do. So there might be something that is faster, but I'm not aware of it. Like, we're just beating all the ECSs pretty much. And I didn't include the other ones from the benchmark, since the graph would just go here, where this is just the lowest ones. Now, what's happening now with specs? We're still growing actively, and we recently got a very important feature to allow more parallelism without actually changing the API, almost without changing the API, as in your regular systems will just automatically get compiled and will be more parallel now. And it works by separating the lock acquisition from waiting. So in this fetch phase, instead of actually waiting for the component storage to be available until everyone else finishes working on that, we just get a ticket. And then when a system departs into its own thread, there is where it starts waiting. So we are able to launch more systems into the flight. And some systems are now working concurrently, which were not doing that before. So you could see like four systems in the graph, and A, B, C, and D are the components that they work. They either read or write a component. So the third system with a smile is what now can start off instantly without waiting for everything else. And without ticketed locks, it was not able to start. We have like a few plans on the future, and the main thing I think is the serialization. That's the most important for the game dev. We want to make the fetch phase more automated, enforced by the compiler. Right now, if you don't call the fetch, for example, we would get a runtime error. That's not a big deal, but it can be prettier, I think. A few people asked for single thread mode, since we do have some overhead for multi-threading, and it is visible on the benchmarks, especially for the few, like for the small component sizes. I don't believe that's going to be visible on any real app, but reducing those sync and send requirements on components would potentially allow some scenarios to happen that are not possible now. And one of the most difficult things that we want to tackle is to integrate with some sort of a job system. What this means is that instead of letting the systems to work on component storages as a whole, we would split each storage into chunks and then allow the chunks to be processed separately. So that is can be seen as an inner parallelism versus the outer parallelism that we have. And the job systems is, again, what every major game engine is doing anyway. So that's the future for us. But it's not clear if Specs is going to be able to get there, or is it some sort of a derivative of Specs that gets there? Now, there's a few ideas of how to overcome the limitations of the entity component systems. And I got one crazy idea a while ago about making the components easy to depend on our other components. This is one of the cases that ECS does not handle well. And my mind experiment concluded that if we allow that, then we don't need entities, since entity is just a bunch of pointers to components. So that's how the component graph system term was born. And the little image on the right is the icon for the prototype that I made for it. It's live, it's on crates.io. And we'll get there in a moment. So this is how the graph looks for it. All you have is just different component storages. Each component can have some data, can refer to other components absolutely free, and it's reference counted for you, so you don't care about lifetimes. So what the Froggy prototype is? It is not an entity component system. And when I say that, what I mean that you cannot say, hey, my system works on this and this component, please run it on all entities. You cannot say that simply because there is no entity. Like, if you need to process something, you may have like a vector of components, or you may have a component storage that you iterate, but you don't compose the system ad hoc like with entity component systems. That's the main difference and main limitation compared to entity component system. But as for an exchange, good thing is it's very flexible. You can encode like any object-oriented class graph in there. You can get automatic nice data placement. You don't need to think about what storage class you need. Like, is it a hash map? Is it a vector? It doesn't matter for Froggy. Everything is just laid out sequentially. There's no gaps. Like, there's a lot of problems that we solved for Specs just don't apply to this thing at all. And there's no trace that you need to implement. You just use the storage as a data type and the pointer. Like, these are two things that the crate provides: the new storage type and the new pointer type, a smart pointer, you would say. An implementation, of course, has just a few unsafe bits, but they're you can observe the code. The code can fit in a few pages. It's really small. There is nothing there. And there is no actual application featuring all of the stuff yet that Froggy can do. The idea to make this thing came from an attempt to map ECS to like a system of drawables where you would have entities, and you would have skeletons, and you would have spatial nodes, and you would want all of it to be in some sort of a managed system. So it doesn't appear to map to ECS, since you would ask yourself what an entity is. Like, is it one piece of a greater object? But then several entities will need to point to the same spatial node. And then how do you represent the node in the entity system? And then this kind of stuff just doesn't work. So with component graph system, it's straightforward. You just map it directly as you think about it, and you benefit from the linear data placement and automatic reference counting. So these are some links for the benchmark, for the Specs, and for the Froggy. And now, since you're falling asleep, I'm going to ask a few quiz questions. I hope you remember everything I said. Does anyone know the original name of Specs? It wasn't published like that. No? It was Parsec, and it appears that Parsec is registered by someone else, so we changed it. The beauty of the Specs name, though, is that it can be read in a multitude of ways, and one of my favorites is the recursive one. Specs parallel ECS can be, like, you know, this geeky stuff. Can you estimate the year when the first entity component systems in Rust started to appear? That's easy. Nope. Great.
So.
Now, another easy one. How many entity component system crates are on the crates IO? And we need a precision of 5, like 1 to 4, 5 to 9, 10 to 14, or 14 to 19. Anyone has a guess? No? 10 to 14, you mean? What range?
Yes.
Yeah, that's correct. Like I'm I counted 13.
Yeah.
Nice one. Yeah. So I also made some extra slides for this very moment. Case studies about the other entity component systems in Rust, because we're not the only one. And first thing to notice is the last commit date. When Specs was, or Parsec was first appeared, ECS started to die, like all around. You would see in April, like three different ECS ended their commitment. I think there is a link, I'm not sure. So this is ECS.rs. It also doesn't have macros, and the problem with it is that every entity is just an any map of components. So whenever you need to iterate through entities and access their components, there is a dynamic dispatch there and a lookup over the map. So it's not pretty, and it's quite verbose. And the good thing is that a system defines what components it works on, and it is allowed to work on these components. Like, there is some sort of a scheduler that enforces that. So that's a nice thing. Now, Trex also died in April, and I say died, sorry, it's been a year. No commits mean that probably not used much. So it does use macros, and there is some sort of simulation. The whole thing is fairly straightforward. There's no parallel workaround. So it seems like a nice experiment that didn't go very far. It is in the benches as well. Now, Tiny ECS, that's an interesting one. Maybe you heard about it. It hasn't died, even though the June last year is the last commit, because there's one little game named Char, and it's been actually greenlit recently. It's a huge Rust game dev project. It's maybe the most successful Rust game ever, and it's being developed, and I think it's using Tiny ECS, since the author is the same, and he mentioned that he's using the ECS from time to time. I don't think he has any incentive to hide the ECS from us. So that's the thing. He he actually has aspects. An aspect is a set of components that the system works on. And there's a few macros, not heavy, but they're visible. Also, some sort of asynchronous entity creation. So you would see how it's maybe a little bit more sophisticated than a beginner's project. And the author himself told me that he would be happy to use specs if it existed by the time he started the project. So it's too late now, and he's invested in it. And I'm happy to see how far Tiny ECS will go. It doesn't look like he's going to go far, though. Like, it seems like it stopped mostly in development. So it's just one of the alternatives that's still viable if people want to try it out. Now, ECS-RS, that's the oldest ECS that I know. Unfortunately, again, last commit is in July. Maybe some specs appeared and confused it. It has very, very complex macro system. That scares me off. And it introduced the hot and cold storage types, which correspond to the vectors and hash maps, basically. The thing that we allow to like arbitrarily choose for you or implement yourself. Yeah. Now, this thing called Constellation, very new. It's been maybe 3 months in development, looks like specs. Like, it's very heavily inspired by specs. However, it's using the change list architecture for mutating components instead of doing it in place like specs. So that's an alternative way that we've been thinking about and discussing prior to me actually creating specs. And I haven't seen a good entity component system performance-wise that would implement this way of thinking. And my co-author, Colin, was also researching this, but he abandoned the idea, and he also realized it's going to be slow. So I'm curious to see how far Constellation will go. And there is also another little one, Calx ECS. It's also really used now. There is a Magog roguelike. It looks beautiful, and you can play it. The system is actively developed from December last year. A single macro just generates everything. The ECS is very simple, but it does serialization, and that's great. The only thing that I don't like about it is that everything is a hash map. So again, the access is not quite linear if you want to iterate it. Yeah, so that's the end of my recap of the existing entity component systems. So now maybe it's time to wake up and ask the questions. Yes.
I'm just curious about what lengths do you have to go to avoid using macros in the
app? The question is how difficult it was for me to avoid macros. What do I have to do? Yeah. So macros come from the idea that your ECS is kind of integrated world with all the components and systems set up at compile time. And the key idea to avoid it was to realize that component storages are actually independent. They may know themselves about what entities they have. And if they're independent, then all you need to handle them at runtime is just an AnyMap. And that's basically what Specs has under the hood. It's just, it's really not a performance concern, since accessing a storage is a one-time operation of a system. Like, the time spent for accessing the storage is incomparable to the time spent to actually going through the entities. So, thinking about independent components and using AnyMap is two things that got us to avoid any macros. More questions?
I need to use it for anything?
Do I happen to use it?
Are you trying to
am I planning to use it? Okay. I've been long trying to integrate it with GFX RS, and people have been asking about how to do this properly. The main problem that people face is that we move systems around threads. So a system can have stuff that it owns, but if its stuff is not sendable, then you're not going to be able to implement a system for it. And the classical example of it is an OpenGL context. You cannot have it inside the rendering system because it cannot be moved to an arbitrary thread. So that's one of the main problems that people were having with specs. So I came up with this little project called like Pegasus, which just shows the general framework of how you would combine these two. And I also have an asteroids clone that's using specs, also like a demo. It's using GFX for rendering as well. And right now, also lately, I've been trying to combine it in a more sophisticated manner, like doing an engine of sorts. And I came up with this document about how we should approach engine design now with parallel entity component systems. And I came up with some sort of a guideline and through this Amethyst project. And we kind of concluded that Amethyst should just follow my guidelines. So I had no incentive to continue doing my own stuff from there. That was sweet. So my next thing is a super secret plan. My next thing is just to combine Froggy with GFX RS, since it's going to be very straightforward. Yeah. Any more questions?
So your benchmarks were only against other Rust ECS, right?
Right. My benchmarks were, I should just repeat, my benchmarks were only against the Rust ECS. Yeah.
So how does it compare to other ones, say, C++?
How do they compare about the C++ benchmarks? That's a perfect question, and we've been wanting, but not putting enough effort to investigate that. There is an open issue on the ECS bench. We probably could do this, but no one stepped in to actually do this. Once we can generate proper Rust bindings for C++ code, now, the most efficient C++ implementations as of late are shipped as just one header full of templates. So that's going to be like sweet to use from Rust. If you want to experiment, we would be very, very welcome and grateful. I'm sure we will beat everyone. So thanks, everyone. I'll just... It's just a little longer to hold before our dinner comes in. What is that, 7:10?
Should we wait then for the next talk?
Oh, 7:20. So it should come in 10 minutes. We can have a break.
I have a break, yeah.
Okay. So feel yourself comfortable.
Yeah. Like, I'm just trying to ask where you are in the process.
I don't have any idea what I'm going to say. No. Maybe you can interview me. No, I just need a bit of a plan. I will do it. All right. So Dimitri wanted me to give you guys more entertainment so that you can spend your time while eating, socializing, and not get too bored. So I'm going to just make up a brief talk until the pizza comes. So that talk is going to be about what Mozilla is doing right now with Rust. And hopefully I can think of enough things to say. So I don't know, has anybody heard of Mozilla's Project Quantum? Yeah, a couple people. Basically, we've made some ambitious little projects to redo big chunks of the Gecko engine that's behind Firefox. So one of those is called Stylo, and that's taking the CSS engine from Servo and putting it inside of Gecko. Stylo has something called parallel styling, so it can do the style calculations that need to be done in parallel. I'm not super familiar with it myself, but from what I've heard, it's taking really good advantage of Rust's thread safety. And I've heard it said that it would be basically impossible to write in C++ and have correct. So that's a big project. There is the other I guess, big Rust-related project is something called quantum rendering, where we're taking WebRender and putting it at the back of Gecko to replace all of its rendering. WebRender is the rendering engine that Servo is using. A couple of us here are working on that. Dimitri is working directly on WebRender. I'm working more on the Gecko integration part. I'm going to talk a bit about that in my integrating Rust into other projects talk later this evening. Yeah, let's ask questions. That's way easier.
Is it possible to do this piecemeal, or is this going to be like a this all has to happen at once, essentially?
Well, like the different projects are happening largely, or so I'll repeat the question. The question was, I guess this is being recorded. Hopefully it's not being published, but I'll repeat the questions anyway. So the question was, how can this happen in piecemeal? So the individual projects don't have any dependency on each other. So Stylo is happening completely independently from WebRender. And in both cases, we're doing it in such a way that basically you can turn it off or on with just a switch. So the existing code is staying there, and we're sort of making it so you can run both. I think hooking up WebRender is going to be a lot more invasive than hooking up Stylo, just because the way that things are drawn is more different. Stylo sort of has I think Stylo is replacing a smaller chunk of the engine. It has sort of a lot more exposure to, like, I guess this will come up later in my talk, but it has sort of more exposure to the engine, but it's a smaller chunk, and there's stuff that comes before it and stuff that comes after it. In WebRender, we're sort of taking all of the graphics code in Firefox and replacing it with something new. So it's going to be interesting how well that integration goes. Sure. So the question was, how far along is Servo compared to Gecko? It's a difficult question to answer. Servo has a lot of different pieces, but to make a web browser really usable, you need sort of all of them. So, like, you can maybe load a website, and it might work in Servo, but it's a long ways away from being able to, like, switch over to a browser that you would use even painfully. It's mostly demoware right now.
So will these changes benefit WebGL and WebGL 2, or are they mostly, is this mostly going to be to benefit HTML,
yes. Yeah. So the question was, will this benefit WebGL or WebGL 2? And the answer is, it won't really have any impact on WebGL or WebGL 2.
Those are already essentially
using the low level API. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay, yeah, the question was, do we know what our next target is to use with Rust? I would like ImageLib, which is sort of the piece of code responsible for loading and decoding images, to move over to Rust. That would be nice. What else would be good? I don't know. I think it sort of depends on the people in those areas and how much they want to not. So one of there are some other places that have moved to Rust. So we have a URL parser that isn't turned on yet, but you can turn it on today and do that in Rust. There's an MP4 parser that is shipping or very close to shipping. There is a bunch of character set conversion code that is being redone in Rust. Those are the parts that I know right now. that are being replaced. The networking layer would also probably be good to redo over in Rust, but I haven't heard of anybody who said that they want to do that. Go ahead.
I was wondering if you're collecting any metrics about like productivity or sticky improvements.
We're not, as far as I know. Yeah, I guess it's not super, like measuring product programmer productivity is pretty difficult. The safety thing, I think we'll more see once we start shipping stuff. And I think that will be really fascinating to see, like, does Rust make a noticeable difference in security? Right, so the MP4 parser that we replaced was sort of a good example for that. It is directly exposed to bytes that are coming from the internet, and the previous code base was terrible C++. And so I think that's gone well, but as we expose more, it'll be interesting to see what the security situation looks like. Any other questions? Go ahead. People in the back say that SpiderMonkey won't be replaced. So one of the things that is being worked on right now in Rust is a code generator called Cretone. My understanding is the intention is that will replace the existing WebAssembly and ASM.js backends. So Rust is creeping in even into SpiderMonkey. It seems like it seems like a really appropriate place for Rust to be used because a lot of security problems happen in that area. Layout, nobody has really talked about replacing that with Rust. So that being layout, being the middle of those two?
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe. I think we're sort of at the point where we have enough work ahead of us that we need to get that done and see how it works before we start committing more in that direction. But everybody who's worked in Rust in Firefox has been positive from what I've heard. So other questions? In the back. So the question was, people have been said to be making games in Rust. What kinds of games those are? What kinds of games are those? I think the whole range. The Char game that Dimitri talked about, I think, is like a for real, you can buy it on the Steam store game. I don't think there aren't any games, I think, that you can go into a store and buy yet, but yeah, I might be able to. Do I have, yes.
Can you compile for Xbox with LLVM?
I think you might be able to, or there's no reason, like Xbox is basically just running Windows, so. PlayStation uses LVM. So this is Char, the trailer. tree. The engine that Char is using is their own? Okay. So now there's food. You can all eat it.
Can I ask one more question?
Yeah, for sure. One more question.
I'm really interested to know, like, there are a lot of resources targeted at, like, beginners, maybe intermediate level Rust developers. Where do people go to become, like, the best kind of Rust programmers?
That is a good question. So the question was, where do people go to become the best Rust programmers? I think the best answer right
now write code.
Is to write code. Yeah. pardon?
But with who?
With
totally not my dog.
No. Write code with other good Rust programmers. So
Alex Crichton, and you shadow him for like
right. So
When you work on open source projects with like some members of the core team, you would file a pull request and they will say everything is wrong about this, and that's where you grow, I think. I'd also like to add before we like start the feast, that the Quantum project in general is associated with Rust, but it's not limited to Rust. It's like, how do we make Firefox great again? It's rethinking of the whole thing. Sorry. It's rethinking of the whole approach. And some parts of the whole approach just happen to be the transition to Rust. But other parts, like the UI thing and the whole event flow in the Firefox, are not related to Rust. And we hope that by the end of the year, it's going to be something entirely new. It's going to be the new Firefox. So you're welcome to pick up everything you can find on the table.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Stuff. Ooh. Wait, yeah, these were coming.
Oh, you do this to me.
Oh, God. Yeah, that's expected. Rendering is just messed up right now. Yeah. I'm guessing Mac is just freaking out. Yeah, there we go. Sorry, what? This is Firefox. Pretty sure it's Firefox. Yeah, I'm just verifying, like, stuff renders right. Dear people, we have two more talks. Let's proceed. You can eat while you listen, hopefully. So Alexis is going to talk about Swift and Rust. He's the very fresh hire in our graphics team. He's also supposed to work on web render. And he worked at Apple, so I leave it to him.
Test, what's up?
Why is the Swift
flying? It's just the way the logo goes. Well, it's you know, dive bombing the world to like save us all. You know? It's from the heavens. all right. So, hey, my name is Alexi. I've been working on Rust, specifically the Rust standard library, for like the last 3 years. Last year, not so much, because I was working at Apple on Swift. So I've spent a lot of the last year thinking about how Rust and Swift compare, because there's a lot of similarities and and a lot of differences, and they're really interesting. So first off, what's Swift? So it's this new open source systems language. It's developed by a major browser vendor, designed to replace the son of C, the cursed one. And it's to make programming easier. And
It's got some interesting features. It's got value types, no garbage collection. It uses interfaces instead of inheritance. Tag unions and pattern matching for all of you functional people. It's got closures also for functional people. And one kind of really important thing for replacing the son of C is good compatibility with legacy C code bases. Oh wait, sorry, I was describing Rust there. so if you like zoom out at a super space high level, they're actually really similar. Like you can make one of these lists and you're like, oh man, it's basically the same language, awesome. And they're so similar that they've actually been able to steal implementations from each other. So Swift came up with this feature called iflet, and the point of iflet was working with optionals was a bit lame. So they came up with this feature that let them just like do an if statement on an optional value a bit easier. And the Rust developers were like, oh, that's cool. Let's copy that, but make it better, because it's weird that this only works with optionals. Like we have all kinds of tag unions and all kinds of patterns. Let's just make it work with any pattern. And then Swift was like, oh, that's a good idea. We'll take that back. So they're so similar that they can just like do this. They can just copy features from each other, and that's really cool. But really, they're actually quite different. Like, I don't think there's any project where I would like take you seriously if you're like, I'm trying to decide between Rust or Swift for this project. Like, if you're saying that, as far as I can tell, you're basically like trying to name drop languages and seem cool. And then if you're doing that, you should like use Erlang or something. Like, use some cooler languages, Erlang and Ada, you know? Rust and Swift are a bit too mainstream. So in particular, I think Rust is way better at systems programming. And by systems programming, I mean like, I want to implement a kernel, I want to implement a database, I want to implement a rendering engine or a parser. You know, like the low core infrastructure of our computing stuff, so like the roads of the computing world. Whereas Swift is a lot better at app development. And by app development, I mean things like, oh, I want to build a GUI, or I want to manipulate a data set, or I want to do some internationalization or some text manipulation, stuff like that. Sorry. and so that's like, you know, the houses that the roads go to. So systems programming and app development are very complementary, but at the same time, fairly different. So why is it that these two languages, which, you know, zoomed out at space are like the exact same language, are so different? And it's because they have different motivations and users, and that led to different philosophies. And then every time they had to make a design decision, that philosophy made them like take a different direction. So here's the motivation for Rust. A slogan you'll hear a lot is safe, fast, concurrent. This isn't like pick two or whatever, it's we want to be all three. And the motivating use case way, way back in the day, and now again today, is Firefox. Firefox is written in C++. And C++ is the cause of, I think, over half of the severe vulnerabilities in Firefox, CVEs in particular. Like, there's just a lot of them that are like, yep, you overflowed a buffer or used after free or whatever, and that's C++. That doesn't happen in Python, or that shouldn't happen in Python. and in addition to being, well, because it's less safe, it also ends up making Firefox less efficient, because everything's so unsafe, you have to start programming defensively. You're like, oh, I probably shouldn't pass a pointer here. I should probably just copy the data because I'm not sure if like they'll interfere with each other. So I'm going to just do extra copies. The idea of doing like more threads is like, no. There's like, Jeff, you were saying like, the new CSS stuff is just like no one would have even considered doing that in C++. And it's because it did more thread stuff, and like C++ is not very good at that. Or at least our developers are not confident in doing that. so yeah, that's where Rust is coming from. Swift, on the other hand, so I don't really, I've never heard this said like in the Swift community, but if you go to like their like blurb on what is Swift, they actually have a bullet list that's like safe, fast, expressive. So it's kind of interesting that like we agree on the first two points and then we kind of diverge at the end. So Swift's motivation is iOS apps. And if you talk to the Swift developers, they'll be very clear, and I agree with them, that they have a goal of working. They want to be like a good choice for no matter what you're doing, right? Doing scripting for a game, writing a kernel, writing an iOS app, whatever, Swift should be a good call. However, in practice, if you look at their users, there's like a million people using Swift for iOS apps, and some people using it for the server, and not much else. So like in practical terms, the people who are using Swift and demanding changes to Swift, they're writing iOS apps. And in that context, it ends up being a different context from Firefox, or the Firefox-like use case. So in Firefox, it's totally reasonable to be like, hey, you need to worry about every single allocation you make. You need to worry about memory management, like care about these things. If I'm like a brand new programmer and the first thing I ever want to do with programming is write an iOS app, which Apple would be super happy for you to do. Yeah, all you should, the first thing you should do with programming, write a cool iOS app. You don't care about these things, right? Like, why would I care about what is memory management? I don't care about this. I just want to write a cool app. So you shouldn't have to care about a bunch of things when you first start getting programming or when you first start making an iOS app. You will if you make something complex enough. Like I'm sure the people working on the Twitter app care a lot about memory management because they're like loading in images and videos and doing like localization and all these other things. But you shouldn't have to care about those things when you get started. So with these different contexts, they've developed different philosophies. Swift cares about progressive complexity, conveniences, and semantics, whereas Rust will focus on essential complexity, uniformity, and implementation. Before I dig into these, I should be clear, these aren't hard rules or anything, these are tendencies. So for either language and for either philosophy, you can find a place where they went either way on it. It's just the places where Swift and Rust diverged, they tend to be kind of around these issues. It's, oh, we had a hard decision to make, Rust went this way, Swift went this way, and they tend to break this way. If you talk to the Swift or Rust developers, they'll also tend to, you'll get kind of a sentiment of, we maybe went too far in the direction we went. Like, Rust went super hard in essential complexity as we went. And if you talk to the, like, what's on the Rust roadmap? They're like, let's dial that back a bit. Let's make things a bit smoother. But these decisions, they tend to have a bit of momentum because people will look at the standard library and they'll go, oh, cool, that's how you make a Rust library. I'm gonna make my libraries like that. And then they're loosening the ecosystem. And then that's how you do Rust. And you know, it's snowballs. So it's hard to change direction once you get set in stone like this. All right, so first let's look at Swift's notion of progressive disclosure of complexity. So the idea with this is there should be a simple way to do things correctly. There might be important complexities in this domain, and they should be hidden as much as possible, but available when you care. So what this looks like for someone who's either new to a domain or new to this library or just new to programming altogether is a very nice, smooth, and gradual learning curve. You know, you start out not knowing a lot, and you can actually get things done. And then when you learn new things or you start caring about things, oh, hey, here's an extra little detail. Here's an extra little detail I can get to them. So some features that are kind of in support of this idea, you can find on how functions work in Swift. So like every cool function calling trick or function declaration trick, like Swift basically has. So there's labeled arguments, variable length arguments, and default arguments. And it might not be obvious how these combine, so let's look at an example. So most important problem in the world. You need it for the most basic program in the world. How on earth do I print a thing? So in Swift, the answer is very easy. There's a function called print. You pass a thing to it. It prints it. Cool. What if I want to print multiple things? Well, variable length arguments. Print just takes more arguments. Awesome. So I can print multiple things. Then you might go, well, what does it put between the things? And I think by default, it'll put commas between the things. And you're like, okay, what if I want semicolons? And it's like, oh, well, what just happened? Okay, it's still working on the other screens. We have labels and defaults. So there's actually a default argument called separator. It defaults to a comma, and we can change it to a semicolon. Great. And in a similar vein, you might go, okay, where is it printing to? And the answer is standard out. And that's another label default argument. So for the novice, they're just like, cool, I can print things. And then as they care about more things, they can care about more things. And this is also empowering to the power user or the expert, because they don't have to use print underscore extreme all the features. And then as soon as they want to print multiple things, they have to specify the separator and toStream and whatever. It's just, oh, you want to print multiple things? Okay, just start printing multiple things. Oh, you care about the separator now? Do that. You care about the output? Now do that. And you can just use whichever ones you want independently. So that's really nice. The expert can care about exactly the details they care about, and the ones they don't care about, whatever. So Rust, by contrast, cares about essential complexity. So something you'll see a lot in the Rust community is kind of an idea of like, hey, this complexity, it's too important. I'm going to deny you progress in running your program until you have demonstrated an understanding of it, because you seem to be doing it wrong. but it's okay, because we're going to try and help you actually learn it. We're not just going to be like, get good, figure it out. We're going to be like, hey, have you checked out this? Have you checked out this? They're like, maybe it's like this. So here's my, or say a bit before this. So the like marquee canonical essential complexity thing in Rust is how ownership is handled in Rust. Does anyone know what the Rust community calls the experience of dealing with this essential complexity?
Apocalypse.
Close. Fighting the borrow checker. I'm going to give it to you. Oh, God. Someone's got that. So yeah, fighting the borrow checker is like this rite of passage in the Rust community. Everyone in like their first one or two weeks, they're just like, oh, I've been fighting the borrow checker and it's the worst. I hate Rust. It's a garbage language. Why would anyone use this? But eventually you get over this hump and it starts to make sense. And one really cool thing is that for novice programmers, this is like a really brutal thing. They're like, I don't understand why this exists. It's like, rather than this nice learning curve of Swift, it's just like learning wall, climb the wall. but once they get over it, like it's a commonly stated thing that like, they feel like they're better programmers now. Like even like people who do a lot of C++, they'll be like, I write my C++ different now because Rust taught me how to do it better. and that's really cool. Like Rust taught you how to do stuff better. And so let's look at an example of this. So here we're just building an array stack and we're passing it to a function twice. So we just want to process an array twice. And because we're using Rust, obviously this doesn't compile because no Rust code ever compiles. That is the safest code, the code that never compiles. And it will say error E0382 use of moved value array. And it'll say, hey, value moved here in your first call to process array and value used here after move in your second call to process array. Note, move occurs because array does not implement the copy trait. So if you're a total novice to Rust, you could very reasonably be like, I don't understand what any of this is. There's a bunch of ideas that or a bunch of concepts that you can start looking up. For an someone fairly experienced with Rust, hopefully like only like a week or two in, hopefully they've seen this and they know how to deal with this. In this case, maybe it's just a copy paste error. They just copied process twice, and you know, my bad. But if you're not experienced, you have these error codes. And if you click on it, you'll get this nice, whoa, that's super tiny. You'll get these nice documentation pages that we've written for like literally every error code. There's probably some that are still undocumented or not documented well, but we're always trying to improve these. If you're looking for a way to improve Rust, this is a really good way to improve Rust. Just like, if you know what the error code is and you can just write the documentation, that's great. If you don't, you know, just start asking questions on IRC and a bunch of people will help you out. But it'll be like, hey, okay, so here's maybe what your code looks like. Here's some different solutions that people have to these problems, and explain, you know, what the problem is about. And in this case, it's even like, this one's really complicated. Maybe read this chapter in the book. Here's a chapter in the book all about it. yeah, cool. So yeah, our compiler is really, really into, hey man, I want to help you learn. One of the coolest descriptions I've heard of this is it's like having your own pair programmer, because they're just like, oh, you made a mistake there, you should fix that. You made a mistake there, you should fix that. No. Trust me, you don't want to build that. So yeah, that's progressive disclosure versus essential complexity. So let's move on to the next philosophy. We have the philosophy of uniformity from Rust. It's pretty common in the Rust community to hear someone say, oh, well, we don't have that feature because actually everything in Rust is already an expression, a value, a pattern, a trait, or a function. And like that just means we don't need it. So the most famous example of this is the ternary. There's a great issue on the Rust repo that someone necros like every 6 months, and they're just like, why doesn't Rust have a ternary? This is a garbage language. And it's, well, and then someone will show up and be like, well, actually Rust is an expression oriented language and everything's an expression. So the if statement actually evaluates to whichever branch it takes. So yay, everything's an expression. We don't need to bother implementing ternary. A bit more complicated case is constructors. So anyone who's used an object-oriented programming language or just a language with types has probably seen constructors. Rust doesn't really have constructors. They just have an idiom for constructing values. And all it is, well, everything is a function in Rust, so just have functions that return the type. And so this ends up being sort of nice in that, like, oh, I don't need to learn a new thing. I just write functions. But it does have a sort of broken record symptom. So it's like impl foo, 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 foo. Like you just repeat the same thing over and over. And you're a bit more verbose, like in Java, you know, foo new would just be foo. So, you know, it's a bit more verbose, but it makes the language a bit more uniform. And that means the language is in some sense shallow. There's actually not that much to learn about the language. It's just learning idioms. So it's like, oh, I don't need to learn constructors. I just need to learn this is what we do to do constructors. Cool. So Swift, on the other hand, is like, oh, I see you have a common pattern there. Let me make it a feature. So constructors, yeah, of course we have constructors. Every language has constructors. Ternary, every language has ternary. We're going to have ternary. This is kind of a... Swift is trying to, you know, make your code as beautiful and as simple as possible. And Rust is just like, I want everything to be the same. So if we look at the constructors example, the Swift code's a lot nicer. There's no broken record. You just say foo once and then everything just works. When you actually construct them, it's the way you expect in every other language. You just say foo, and you get a foo. However, this design has a bit of a limitation. the downside of this, oh, I'm going to make a feature for that so it's a bit more ergonomic thing, is when you run off the edge of the pattern the feature is trying to capture. So here's a really simple example. I just want to have two constructors that have the exact same argument set, but do different things. So here I want to have a foo and a foo secure. So this just like doesn't work in Swift. You have to do something different. The two idioms I've seen are, you have a dummy argument in your constructor, you just pass it the empty tuple, which is like gross, but like kind of fine. And the other one is, oh, okay, just do static functions, which is just be rest. but it's awkward because you're like, oh, the idiomatic nicest thing is when I use the actual constructor thing, but I've like fallen off the edge, so now I have to like make this decision. And of course, Rust, it's fine. They're just functions. There's a foo new and a foo secure. Hooray. So that's the conveniences versus uniformity. So
Just a quick note that I found it very useful to use self inside Impl, so that you don't repeat yourself a lot.
Yeah, so.
Repeat yourself.
Yeah, Dimitri is correctly noting that all the best programmers will use capital S self in literally any opportunity where it applies. I totally agree. I was basically, punching below the belt on Rust, making it a little nastier, but it would still be like just as verbose. Like you'd be like, oh, it has to return something, where most other constructors in every other language is like, it's a constructor. There's nothing to return. It's the type. Implementation versus semantics. These two are like really closely coupled, so I'm not going to try and split them out as much. Also, I ran out of steam around this part of writing the talk, which I definitely finished a long time ago and definitely not an hour before this. So implementation versus semantics is basically asking the question, should the user care about allocations happening, about the cost of an operation, or if there's some tricky optimization that we're doing, which will make their code faster in like 80% of the cases, but in 20% of the cases, now they have like a weird wacky cliff that they fall off. So Rust, we tend to err on the side of implementation. We say the users will care about the implementation. The implementation is almost like an aspect of the semantics. So here we have a really simple toy example. We just want to make a array vec or array stack, copy it to another variable, and then mutate the first one, but not mutate the second one. So in Rust, the way you do this, you make your array stack, and then you say clone the first one. And clone is Rust's like catch-all, do a copy, but it's more than a copy thing. So you could say it's a deep copy, although there's several people who will then complain. I found the way to satisfy the most people is to declare it a sheep copy, but no one knows what that is. It's like a copy that's deep enough. reference counting being the weird case that makes it a sheep copy. And then once you've done the clone, you're done, you've done the sheep copy. Everyone can see that you've done the sheep copy, they just scan the code for clone, and then you can just do your mutation and it's gonna do the most obvious thing, it's just gonna change that value. Okay, that's pretty simple. Let's look at Swift's approach to this. So Swift is more focused on semantics, and so the code ends up being a bit more magical. So first line, again, doesn't matter. This is how you create an array stack in Swift. The second line, it just assigns X to Y. And the magic here is this will trigger ARC, which is atomic reference counting in Swift, automatic reference counting. In Rust, it's atomic reference counting, and that's been incredibly confusing for the past year for me. this will trigger automatic reference counting, and it's basically X is actually just a pointer. It will look in the pointer and increment some number behind it. And then X and Y will actually be exactly the same value. They will be both a pointer to the same thing because collections in Swift are copy on write. But the semantics that Swift declares here is that X and Y are distinct values, even though they are literally the same value. And the way that works is when we go to mutate X, it will go, hey, am I actually the only one pointing at this? It will see no, and then it will do what clone did in Rust. It will do a sheep copy. It'll copy all the data and create a new allocation and all that stuff. So these two pieces of code end up doing the same thing in the end. So the semantics are preserved. You know, they are independent. They're observably independent values. But the implementation is very different. And if you care about the implementation, you care about this distinction a lot. And you can care about it for a few reasons. So the implications of focusing on implementations, one thing is it's really, really easy to understand code. So you can just look at code and be like, oh, I see all of the clones that are happening. These are the hot spots for performance I should check out. It's also really easy to do tricky things. So one kind of implementation constraint that we've been kind of pushing the boundary of in some discussion recently is vec and string in Rust are like dead simple. They are a pointer, a capacity, and a length. They don't do any copy on write stuff. They do some cute optimizations with like zero size types that most people should never care about. For most types, it's just like, yep, it's like the textbook implementation of an array stack you would imagine. And that means people can do things like, I'll grab the pointer and take ownership of it and pass it to some C code, and then the C code can free it because I know the capacity and I know the allocator and all that good stuff. If we want to do these tricky optimizations, we actually just break that. And people are already doing these tricky things, so we probably can't do any cool optimizations with vec. If you want like a cool optimization with vec, implement your own type and you will know that those optimizations are happening. So downsides of focusing on implementation is, so this one's an interesting one. Developers will kind of overreact and freak out. They'll be like, oh, I see there's a clone in this code. I must eliminate this clone. And when you think about it, you're like, this is ridiculous. Because so like, here's an example for me. I was working on crates.io and I noticed like we were cloning a string or something. And it's like, okay, we cloned the string. That's like bad. I'll try and eliminate this. And then Alex Creighton, he was like, don't like, you're about to start a database query. Like that's like 10,000 times more expensive than copying the string, who cares? And yeah, you need to like keep that stuff in mind. So I think there's like a bit of a curve where like when you start doing Rust development, you kind of will aggressively clone because you can't deal with a borrow checker and you just want to like get things done. Then eventually you'll start to understand things and you'll want to kill every single clone in the universe and you'll be freaking out. And then eventually you hit kind of a zen state where you're like, I don't care. and yeah, that's a nice place to be. The other downside of this is you're throwing away optimization opportunities. So like I was describing before, there's a bunch of hypothetical optimizations we could do with vec and string that we've just taken off the table. We're just like, nope, we care about the implementation. People should be able to reason about like weird, tricky things about the implementation. So we're not allowed to do optimizations. So with semantics, the biggest win of semantics is you can make sloppy code go faster. This is the sufficiently smart compiler argument. Swift has been described as basically a make work project for compiler implementers, because like they have made every decision possible to like optimize your sloppy code. they want to do everything, even things that like even C++ was like, nah, I'm good. and you can make a better learning curve. So with the Swift code that I showed was a lot simpler. You didn't have to care about this idea of clone. You're just like X equals Y, and I don't know, some magic will make these independent, whatever. Eventually you'll figure out that magic and you'll maybe start caring about it. And then you get to the downsides, which is, although you can make sloppy code go faster, suddenly you need to make sloppy code go faster because everyone is writing sloppy code. And actually it becomes hard to tell if you're writing sloppy code because there's random places where you fall off an optimization. So this is a legitimate problem in the Swift like compiler is, oh, or well, the Swift compiler and the Swift standard library is, oh shoot, this thing which should go fast actually takes a really long time because you fell off ARC optimizations and we accidentally incremented your reference count. And now you're doing like an O of N copy on every single iteration of your loop and bad times. And the other downside is the flip side of implementation, and it's hard to do tricky things. Writing unsafe code in Swift is way more terrifying to me than writing unsafe code in Rust because Swift has just reserved tons of things that you're like, maybe I can re-. So like one really common thing people will try and do in Swift is return a pointer from a function. And there's cases where you could, where you like look at the code and you'd be like, oh yeah, that makes sense. I passed in a pointer to a thing on the stack and then I returned that pointer. The thing on the stack is still there, so that pointer should still be good. And Swift says, no, we reserve the right to move that thing. That thing might be gone. And there are some legitimate cases where this is actually important. And a lot of people are just writing this code, which just returns pointers up the stack. And Swift says, we're going to break you one day, probably. it's a lot harder to do tricky things. And I think that is it. Yeah, so that is the philosophies of why Swift and Rust have diverged and become significantly different languages is that they cared about progressive complexity, conveniences, and semantics, and Rust cared about essential complexity, uniformity, and implementation. Cool.
So is the semantics of the Swift program that y equals x is the same as the Rust program? Does it do copy on write?
Yeah, so all Swift collections are copy on write. But it's weird. So Swift has a lot of C++ blood in it. Like a lot of the core Swift team is just like people who worked on C++ and got mad and were like, I'm going to build my own language called Swift with what's the thing that implements that gives like traits to templates? Yeah, I'm going to add concepts and modules and all the things C++ keeps kicking down the road. If you ask them, they'll be like, oh, this is value semantics. So it's value semantics in much the same sense of C++, where it's like, oh yeah, these are different values semantically, but that might only be realized eventually, maybe. So Swift, this is something I forgot to mention in my presentation. Swift is actually working on adopting an ownership model inspired by Rust, but it is different. When I was there at Apple, I was like, hey, like here's the Rust ownership model, here's like the design constraints, and they're like, okay, we don't want this. The borrow checker experience of like, here's a wall, climb it, that is completely opposed to their philosophy and they don't want that. So what the ownership model in Swift is going to look like is more of optimization hints. Not necessarily optimization hints, but like opting into move semantics and like, okay, I want move semantics for this type. Let's do this. I'm willing to actually care about this. And almost every type that a normal user will experience will just have copy semantics and it'll be fine. The actual question was about pass by value and pass by reference. So Today, there is semantically only really pass-by value, but there is basically pass-by reference and then future pass-by reference. So basically pass-by reference is Swift's in-out style, and it's basically, it's semantically, you pass the value in, and then when the function returns, it will be passed back out to wherever you put it. This is in a few other languages. I think C# has a similar concept to this. And yes, semantically it's passing by value, but in the implementation, everyone knows it's actually passed by reference. Because for almost everything, why would I pass this by, like in and out? I'll just pass in a pointer to it. Again, there's cases where it will actually do an effective copy in, copy out, at least to a temporary for reasons. Swift is a very deep language and has many fun features that makes things complicated. In the farther future, Swift will have something closer. So in-out is basically the mutable reference in Rust. In the future, they will probably also have an immutable reference sort of thing. I always called it in-only. I think they're going to call it share. That's what it was in the last document I saw.
Okay, so I actually did try to look at Swift.
Cool.
In terms of how do you get it working with a pre-existing C++ library. So let me have a question. Can that magic be made to work on user-defined type?
So the question is Swift's magic, can a user opt into this magic? Can they have, I'm guessing you're thinking of things like copy constructors and move constructors.
Yes, I mean, controlling, so like, of course you have lifetimes in a C++ library, right? We want to make it easier, easier in the same way that normal Swift code would make it.
So yeah, if you look at the implementation of Swift, it is currently structured in a way in that theoretically you could override copy and move. Currently, you are not allowed to override copy and move. The only copy constructors are the only copy and move constructors are arc stuff. So I'm going to mess with reference countings. And the reason there's move constructors is because Objective-C has a really wacky version of reference counting where like there's a map somewhere that points at every value, and that map needs to be updated every time you move the value. And that's some cool, fun Objective-C magic. It's unclear whether they will ever act. So there are theoretical ambitions for Swift to like have perfect like magic FFI to C++, and the world will be great. It's unclear if that will ever be implemented or if that's really worth it. Because having like real copy constructors and move constructors will inhibit things like optimizations. Like right now they can do optimizations knowing, oh yeah, every kind of copy constructor, move constructor, it does this one thing. It doesn't have interesting side effects. It doesn't have all these other things. They can properly optimize them. Yeah, so the question is there anything I don't like in Rust? There's definitely some things I don't like in Rust. On the spot, I'm having trouble remembering like the really good ones. I have a bunch of petty ones that are based around like things I worked on that like never got stabilized or got rejected or something. But in the context of this talk, one thing that I really wish Rust had is the function argument stuff that I showed. So like labeled arguments, default arguments. There's some opposition to these in the Rust community because they do exactly the things Swift is using them for. They hide details. And there's some really hardcore people who are like, I want to see all the details. Like, never hide anything from me. And like, there's a certain merit to that, but like, there's also, moderation. I would really like labeled arguments for unsafe APIs in particular. So a really good example, something you were working on actually, mixing up arguments to some of the unsafe functions does very bad things. So for instance, mixing up length and capacity when building up a vector from raw parts will do very bad things. another good one is mixing up the arguments to memcopy will also do really bad things. And it'd be nice if there was just like a from and to label on those arguments. Swift also actually has labels on tuples. So like your multiple return types, it can actually label like, this one's the length, this one's the capacity. Now you know. so that's like all the things that bother me about Rust are like where it makes writing unsafe code harder than it should be, basically.
Not a very concise question, but do you have an opinion on like where actual language syntax would fit into these verses? If, for example, if you go back to where you declare an array stack in Rust versus where you declare it in Swift, like even just that, ignoring maybe like the type declaration, or was like, do you think like in which verses would that syntax sort of complexity fit into?
Yeah, so the question is basically what syntactic choices apply to what philosophies?
Yeah.
So in the Swift case, the reason it's like so undecorated is because fixed sized arrays like on the stack literally do not exist in Swift. So this is the only kind of array is the growable array. If you look at, so Swift actually is better at Rust at FFI because Apple is really good with clang. So they just have like clang inside of Swift. So it can just like import C headers and like figure stuff out. And it's really cool. And if you look at how it bridges in arrays, it's just a tuple. It's just like T, 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 T. This is sort of like almost inoffensive or irrelevant syntax in this particular case, because it's like there's only one kind of array, it's this kind. So I do like in Rust that we don't make growable arrays totally. So one thing Swift actually does is it lets you actually override a lot of syntax and a lot of literals. So there's a long running joke in the Swift community that the expression 1 + 2 + 3 + 4 + 5 will crash the compiler, and it will declare this expression is too complicated. And the reason this expression is too complicated is because 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 can all infer to different types based on overloaded literal stuff that could be in like any library. And then those pluses could be overloaded by anyone. And it turns out that the inference problem is actually quite non-trivial. There's probably a really easy optimization where you just try and set them all to the same value or something, and then it's really easy. But I think... Yeah, this is a really big question. One big thing is the semantics versus implementation thing, operator overloading and that sort of stuff. Like any overloading of syntax is pretty opposed to reasoning about implementations. So like Rust does let you overload operators, but it comes with a big asterisk of please don't actually use this. Like only use this if you're literally implementing an integer type, because that is the only case where we think it's reasonable to, or maybe matrices too, but like don't use this for stuff. Like don't override bit shift to be sending packets. don't. Yeah, so there's the complaint. You have a similar thing with Arc in so in Rust, you know, let x equal y is going to do something very trivial. It's going to do a memcopy. If x was already initialized, or in the let case, no, yeah. So in let x equals y, the memory was previously uninitialized. There's no copy constructors, there's no move constructors. It's just going to do a memcopy. And so that's another case of reasoning about implementation. Whereas in Swift, let x equals y can do reference counting stuff, and then which, like, in the case of Swift could be like, oh, we have to go to that global map that's tracking all of these pointers to this type and like do all sorts of stuff. Other syntactic differences is how you differentiate between virtualization and not virtualization. Or how you do virtualization. So in a lot of languages, if I say this variable has the type of an interface, then that's implicitly some boxed thing that which does virtual dispatch. In Rust, you're like not allowed to do that. You have to say, oh, this is a box containing this. This is a reference count pointer containing this. And there's some argument about whether it should be some other new concept and whether we'll get Rust 2.0, but that's a whole bag of worms. I'll leave that at there. Any other questions?
So as you mentioned, that Swift sort of has goals that eventually could be doing more and more low-level things. Are those ideas floated around for Rust to maybe do higher-level things like app development?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Everything on the Rust roadmap is about making higher-level development easier. One of the things discussed was like one thing new developers run into right away is the difference between stir and string. Like literally this comes up when you're trying to write hello world is like, oh, I need to talk about stir versus string. Great. There was some discussion of making static stir, so string stir literals, coerce into a string and then doing some copy on write magic so it's actually free. But this was the implementation issues with tricky optimizations that I said probably doesn't work out. I spaced out. What was the actual question? Right. Yeah. So how is Rust trying to be higher level? So that's one case. If you look at the, does anyone in this room remember what the roadmap is called? It's like the road. Is it just the Rust 2017 roadmap or something?
Roadmap
for 2017. There's a lot of good stuff in there discussing how we're trying to make Rust a little better for high-level uses. So, well, sort of. So the question is Rust going to ever have a garbage collector or something like that? Yeah. This is sort of being looked at by Felix and Manish still, yes?
Yeah. They're still looking at it.
Yeah. So the GC stuff Rust will maybe one day have is integration with other languages' garbage collectors. So the most obvious motivation for this is, hey, we're working on Firefox. We have this thing called JavaScript. A lot of our stuff is maybe garbage collected. It's a real problem that our Rust code just kind of clobbers that a lot because it can't track it. So that's probably the only place Rust is going to do any kind of garbage collection stuff is just being able to correctly handle other languages' garbage collectors. Native, like, yeah, stuff just works, garbage collection in Rust is probably not going to happen.
There are really slow implementations.
Okay. Apparently there are some weird implementations that are safe, but are maybe kind of weird.
It's very slow. It's called Rust GC.
Okay, something called Rust GC. First I've heard of it. Very slow. Any other questions? So what IDE do I use? Personally, I use Sublime Text with like basically just syntax highlighting. I've been meaning to try out Visual Studio Code because everyone keeps saying that the new plugins for Rust are like really great and actually do useful things. Up until recently, it kind of didn't matter because there just like wasn't any good tooling for Rust. Although I think some people got like C tags or something working in Vim. I don't know. But yeah, I just use Sublime Text because I'm a peasant. Yeah.
Before, back in one of the early slides, you contrasted Rust with C, Bash, and Concurrent.
Yep.
And while you said Swift was C, Bash, and Express. Now, is there, what's the concurrency model?
Oh, okay. So the question is, what is the concurrency model for Swift? And the answer is no. it's basically Swift is like currently thread unsafe. I believe concurrency is on the roadmap for Swift 5.0, which would be the release they start developing next year. Yeah. It's basically nothing right now.
As Rust kind of evolves towards making things easier for people, be a little more expressive, let's say, about how far down that path do you think Rust would go? Like, would it ever get to the point where you have an assignment doing a crazy copy thing, or is there like a really strong intention?
Yeah, so the question is basically how high level will Rust ever become? For instance, will you one day be able to just write let x equal y and it actually executes code that does copies and stuff. So I can't predict the future, but I expect Rust will get higher level in some places. But things like, so the thing you're talking about is a proposal called autoclone. I doubt autoclone will ever be accepted because there's a significant and powerful contingent of Rust users who are just like, no, never. This would destroy Rust. I don't expect Rust will climb a lot higher. So there's some people who believe in the vision of the one true language that does all things great. I am personally not convinced of this. I think you need to pick a place where you're centered. You can stretch to do high level stuff, or you can stretch to do low level stuff, but you're gonna pick a place where you're like real good. And I think Rust is pretty anchored in like, we're doing some low level stuff. Let's have Jeff give his talk.
I'll try using. Are you gonna do some giveaways while I'm getting set up?
Do you know how to start this? Oh, up here. Oh, is there a way to make it so that it just shows the slides? Yes.
Look at that.
All right. So, integrating Rust into existing projects. This is mostly what I do as a job now. But first, why would you want to do this? It depends on the language that your project is otherwise written in. So, if you're in a dynamic language like Python, Ruby, JS, or R, some of the reasons you might want to do this would, I think the probably the big one that I've seen is performance. Those languages are not very fast, and sometimes you need to get a lot of stuff done quickly. So all of these languages generally will go down into C or C++. Rust is an alternative to that. And the big advantage that using Rust has over C or C++ is you get to maintain safety. Other reasons why you would want to integrate Rust with these other languages are easy parallelism. Python, Ruby, JS, and R both all don't have great stories for parallelism. Type safety is another one. And I sort of spoke about this before, but the alternatives for integrating with these other languages are limited because a lot of other programming languages come with some runtime, and it can be really difficult to mix runtimes. Rust has no real runtime, or its runtime basically looks like C, and so you can stick it in most places, you can stick C. Let's say you used a compiled language like C#, Java, Scala, Go, Erlang, or Elixir. It's not as compelling, perhaps, to use Rust in these cases, but you can get more performance. There are value types, monomorphized generics, and you have a lot more control over your memory usage. And again, there's a nice parallelism story. Finally, if you're using an unsafe compiled language like C or C++, probably, at least for us, one of the big things is safety. Memory safety is huge for us because we're exposed to random stuff from the internet, and the data race safety that you get is nice for parallelism. Rust has some nice ergonomics compared to C++. So pattern matching, type inference, proper move semantics, and error handling are all nicer in Rust than they are in C++. The parallelism, again, is really nice. And Rust has a good ecosystem. So there's not really a package manager for C or C++, or a standard build system. And so there's a lot of, oh, I need to do YAML parsing. Well, I better write a YAML parser because I don't want to have to make my build system work with the YAML parsers that are out there, their build system. So then the next question might be how to integrate. There are piles of different things that will help you integrate Rust into a variety of different languages. So I'm just going to go through them quickly. It's basically GitHub URLs and some examples. This is sort of a hello world that you could call from Python that calls back into Python. The project is Rust CPython. There's a project called Helix that lets you declare things that you can call from Ruby. Here we're again doing something sort of hello world-ish. You can see it being called there at the bottom. Ruru is another thing. This is an implementation of string blank. That's probably fast. That maybe is faster than in Ruby. I don't know. I'm not that familiar with Ruby. Here's something for R, Rust R. Again, it's just a Fibonacci function. There's a project called Neon. For integrating with Rust and Node. It looks pretty nice. For Java, there's something called Rukaja. Part of the fun of this part of the presentation is just the names, really. That's for sort of controlling Java. And then there's JNIRS that lets you have sort of safe JNI access through Rust. So again, hello world. Go, there's not really a great story, but since Rust can behave like C, you can interoperate with Go as well as you can with C. Fortunately, with Go, that's not very well. Erlang, there's something called Rustler. I guess this is just adding two numbers. It's not the prettiest thing to look at, but it looks like it's probably safe. And then for C and C++, this is the area that I've done most of the stuff that I've done in. So Rust and C have a basic or have decent out-of-the-box interoperability, you can just take a Rust function and add no mangle and extern C to it, and then you can just call it from C, away you go. To actually do that from the C or C++ side, you need a header. So there are different ways to get those things. A lot of people are just handwriting headers. In WebRender, that's what we were doing. There's something called Rust bindgen for when you want to go in the other direction. So that will take C++ headers and generate Rust code that expresses the same things. There's something called Rusty Cheddar that generates sort of more generic bindings, I think something like Swig. And you can also just write a custom header generator like we are switching over to for WebRender. So some examples, I guess before I get to these, so the current things that have been implemented in Rust in Gecko are just using handwritten C headers. They have pretty small API surfaces, so it's easy just to write a function that's like parse URL, and here's an object, and you can query things out of it. but Stylo, which is Servo style system, is using Rust bindgen. It's the main consumer of Rust bindgen, as far as I know. Basically, the reason it needs to do that is there are these things in Gecko called style structs, and they sort of describe the style information that comes in and goes out, I guess. And it's a bunch of C++, and it is easiest just to make it so that Rust can operate on those things. And Rust bindgen uses Clang to basically parse those headers and generate the Rust. It doesn't support everything that you can do in C++ because that's very difficult. There's a list there of the things that aren't supported. In WebRender, we're currently using a handwritten C header, but we're going to be switching. In fact, actually today we switched to a generated header. So this was a reasonably quick project. Rust is easy to parse. There's a library called syn. It gives you just an AST, and it's pretty easy to walk over some Rust and generate a kind of the header that you would write manually for that. syn is sort of new, so some of the other projects probably didn't take this approach just because they're older. And the previous parser for Rust called Syntex was not as pleasant. All right, so integrating is not always pleasant. Many of the integration solutions that I went through are pretty young and haven't had big mainstream projects using them. Stylo has really pushed forward what bindgen can do. We're sort of the first people using syn to generate our own headers. I went through a bunch of projects for interoperating with other languages, but I don't actually know any for real examples of those projects being used in production. So things are pretty young and people are still exploring the best ways to do all of these things. Another problem is build system integration. Integrating build systems is probably as hard or harder than integrating the languages. Because at least with languages, Rust can pretend to be like C. For build systems, they're mostly non-designed to interoperate. And so I think there's some interesting problems that still need to be solved in this area. So getting near the end here, there have been other successful integrations. So Sentry, I guess that they're a company that does sort of error reporting from web applications. They use source maps to map from the minified JS back to the real JS. They had that written in Python, and it was slow, And so they switched to Rust and it was much better. Here are pictures of the switch to Rust. You can probably see the switch to Rust without it being annotated. That one's nice. Another project is librsvg. It's the GNOME SVG library. They shipped Rust code in 241.0, and are incrementally converting more C over to Rust and seem to like it a lot. And that's the end of the presentation. Questions?
Binding.
Yeah.
So you use Clang, right? So do you talk to a C++ library at
A? Yes. So yeah, so I bet I could show. Can I show? Maybe not. The Rust code that you're gonna generate is yeah. I don't have good workplace management or workspace management. Yeah, the Rust code you're gonna generate is not gonna be pleasant to look at. And
no, but I love that.
Yes. Oh, yeah, for sure. And in theory, in the future, maybe you'll be able to like inline across between C++ and Rust. Like, they both use LVM, and so these things are possible. Yeah, I think it's a place. Alexei talked about Rust goals, and integrating well with other projects is important in there. Helix and Neon, which I mentioned, are called out explicitly in the Rust goals as important things, and BindGen is certainly important too. Other questions? Yeah, in the back. Yes. So there's the Rust compiler. Yeah. So the question was, do you need to use a special compiler to use Rust? Yeah. So there's just the one Rust compiler right now. It's implemented on top of LVM. So it just takes in the text. So there's IDE support that's being worked on. And that, again, is another thing called out in the goals. Is to improve IDE support. And I think with Rust, it can make a big difference. It's sort of like IDEs make an enormous difference if you're programming in Java. And I think that will probably be true of Rust because you get to have better tools for dealing with some of the repetitiveness or explicitness. I know in Rust, if you're refactoring, it can be a big bag of pain just because like the compiler has a lot of complaints. Other questions? All right, great. Thank you very much.
Something like this?
More than once a year.
Yes. Once a month?
3 months? 6 months?
Would people